Right, here we go then, guys. Some tips about fishing. I thought I'd show you the pond. You can tell it's winter now. The fish are hiding right in the corner down there. Can I zoom in on them? No. But anyway, so I just thought I'd quickly show you the pond in winter. You see how different it looks now, man. How different it looks, isn't it, Scraps? Eh? Here's your ball. Chase the ball, mate. Right, so we were talking about tips for fishing. How to up your catch rate and why I catch so many fish. Hey, we find out the reasons, not by accident. And here's my tank. It's a little bit green at the moment, to be honest. The lilies are still going. They're still going. The fish are all happy. Got some babies. Right, I can quickly show you my setup as well, what I've been doing to catch my pikies. That's my tripod, so don't worry about that. But this is what I take, and that's my other lure rod. Basically, I'm going to be talking about my rods and talking about how I fish and why I fish certain venues. I'm going to turn off the TV now. There we go. Right, so I'm going to be talking about my rods, how I fish, why I fish the certain ways I do. No doubt I'll have someone moaning. But to be fair, I'm actually doing this for more information for me and for you guys, because I've had a few people messaging me and I haven't gone into detail how I'm actually fishing. And it's very simple, but if you don't know, you don't know. Right. All right, guys. I don't normally advertise stuff, you know, but I'm just going to tell you the net I've been using. I've been using this Grays net. I got this when I first started fishing. As you can see, it's got a couple of holes in it, but it's a rubber net, so you don't get stuff caught on it, you know what I mean? So the hooks don't get caught, and like it's really easy to use on a hook, and it's cheap. So I've kept it. I've had it since I started fishing, about 4.5 years now, and it's lasted that well. And I've had a lot of pike in this thing. Obviously, I've caught a lot of carp in it, loads of stuff. But I wouldn't use it again for carp. I've got a decent net for that now. But for pike, it's perfect, trust me. But I'm really going to get a bigger one soon, because I'm going to be fishing for some bigger pike. But for what I'm doing, ditch fishing, man, this net is perfect. So bear in mind, when I'm talking about my pike fishing, I'm about my pike fishing. I'm not fishing for bloody 30s. It's like when I'm talking about the carp kind of stuff, you get, you know, the elitists. They're like, you got to be using 60-pound braid. Da, da, da. It's like, dude, I'm fishing a ditch. Chill out, man. Sorry about that, guys. It's a manufacturing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you my rig for pike fishing, ditch fishing. So some people like, even on the pike page, they're like, you're using a flake rod? It's like, yeah, there's methods in the madness. I've tipped a corner, I've got everything tangled up. And this wire trace, I'm actually getting rid of now, before anyone starts crying about that. I just basically, it's been used a lot, and you shouldn't keep using the same wire trace. I'm not going to set up the whole float rod, because you know what float rod is, Jesus. I'm not going to think you're all stupid. But here's my rod, right? It's 8-pound line, and as you can see, it's old school, emerald match pond float rod, and I paid £10 for it, so it's a badass little rod. I love it. It's not even a little, sorry, it's a 14 foot float rod. I love it. It's a really good rod. But some people will be saying, like, how can you use a float rod? Two reasons, because I'm fish, as you know, on little ditches, and if I'm struggling, and when I go to different venues, and I'll explain more into it, but I have to have other options. So if I was blanking on the pike video, I could have went for the roach or the chub, you see what I mean, with the float rod. If I've got a small quiver tip rod, a small lure rod, I can't float fish with it. So I really can only quiver, you know, only, what's it called? Feeder fish. Only lure fish with it. So do you know what I mean? So I just thought, what's the point? So I take the float rod with me, so I've got other options. And when I explain in a minute why I fish different venues, sometimes you need rods what are versatile. I can't just have a rod what just only does one thing. You notice that, because I kind of get annoyed, because if I'm certainly doing different types of fishing, like going on the river, and then I might be going on the lake, I need to be able to change the rods into two different things, you see? I've got different spools for different heavy lines and stuff like that. As you can see, Scott's waiting for the ball. But this is the wire trace I use. Okay, you can see it's bent because I've obviously had loads of pike on it, loads of little jack pike on it. And I'll show you the lure that I'm using. But I'll explain why my lures, you know, I'm not really lure crazy, you know. It's on my videos, I barely show the lure, because to me, it's kind of irrelevant. And some people who are crazy on lures, just bear in mind, I'm fishing ditches. Pike that I haven't seen lures before, okay? So this is the one that I've been doing the videos on recently, okay? Right? I used to take this treble out. When there's a lot of weed in the bottom, I take this treble out, so it's just one hook, basically. And when you first start fishing, this is one of my favorite lures, as you can see how old it is, because I didn't cast into trees and lose my lures. I haven't in a long time. I will now, next time I go fishing. But this one used to do me a lot of fish. It's the colour's gone in it. It's a bit, you know, a bit dead now, and it's not that bright. But this used to catch me a lot of fish. Obviously, you can see the treble's gone. So when there's a lot of weed and I'm fishing, you know, this deep, literally in some spots, I've got to be able to drag it through really quick. And that just that little wabbling tail is enough. And the red colour just gets them going, like little perch or whatever else they think it is. But basically, these type of lures are fine. And I'll show you what I mean. Like, that's the same again. Like, I'm not worried about the only lure I've got, what is good, and if you want to watch my old lure fishing videos when I surface fish with this bad boy, this is my favourite lure. I'm not going to lie, because I paid a lot of money for it. And when I say a lot of money, I paid £6. It's a lot of money to me, right? The Savage Bee lure. Okay, I don't normally do brands and stuff, as you know, I don't really care. But this was their own, you know what I mean? I can't say it's not, and it is, okay? It's a Savage Gear Bee. It's bloody awesome, honestly. I've caught so many little jackpike on this. But like I said, I think any surface lure would do. Look, and I'll show you what I got given the other day. Where I'm fishing, just keep this in mind. Ditch fishing, all right? yeah, there you go. So I got from Steve at Lake to Lake Live Streams. little popper, all right? That would be do exactly the same, trust me. I've got one of these bad boys. I'm going to try that in a couple of weeks. But all these little things, trust me, all these would work on these waters that I fish. And I seen this in there. I thought this was really cool. It's like a little black bug. I think that's going to be awesome. But all these little things will catch me. Honestly, I'm that confident on the water, that all these little ditches that I fish, that they're going to hit anything, because I've caught on everything from worms to little spinners. So yeah, basically, the point I'm making is, I'm not care about my lure. My lure is literally not important. As long as I can fish it effectively in the water that I'm fishing, that's what I care about. So if it's on a surface or it's on the bottom or it's mid-water, you know, that's what I care about. So basically, I've got a couple of minnows that I always take with me. But you got to remember as well, I've done a lot of fishing, obviously, off YouTube. So a lot of these places you're seeing me fish, I've already fished them loads of times, so I know them like the back of my hand. And you hear me say a lot of time on that last pike video, I knew there's going to be a pike here, or I know there's pike here, because I've been there, I've seen the pike there before. I like to be a master of my own environment, if that makes sense. So I don't like travelling. I like travelling where I can go, so I can, if I get a water, I want to be able to just fish my ass off on it, you know. And any of the waters around here, you know, I can go to them when I want, or I can at least go once a week. And in my opinion, to get used to any water and get really good at fishing those waters, you need to go to them all the time, even if only once a month, so you get used to the water. I go to those ditches once a month, easy. And I'm always seeing stuff going on. Even when I just ride by to my bike, I always have a little look. So yeah, this is what I say about my lures. I've got loads more lures upstairs, but honestly, when I've been fishing that, when these little river ditch fishing, the pike hit anything, man, they miss it and come back like 3 times, man, because they've never been up before. But this and my other cheap wire tracers, they're the green ones, you know what I mean? Not really too much of a fan of them, but the wire tracers are so cheap, man, you can get them. But like, I'll show you this one, the one I've got on my thing. It's actually a short wire trace, but it's just I think it's £25 wire trace, and I've got £10.9. And people be like, you need 60-pound braid. It's like, no, I don't. I'm fishing ditches, mate. I do not need that. There's not, well, as you've seen, there's not many snags and stuff. But when you're bait fishing, you need like £15, £18 mono. That was, even for me, I've been finding out a lot about why people use such heavy gear when they're baiting. I get it, because if you snap off, I've never snapped off yet, see. So I don't want to, you know, use £12 line and then cast out a mackerel and it snaps off and I kill a pike because it's got treble stuck down it with no way of getting rid of it. So I get why you use the heavier line, and I was like listening, but I always look on the pike pages. Honestly, if you want to get into pike fishing, there are actually some of them are more, get more info out of them than you do off the YouTube channels. Because again, like when you see the YouTube channels, majority of the people watched one earlier, it's just selling, isn't it? You know, and you're like, information. But the reason why you're using such heavy stuff, and even when I fished one of my other good pike anglers, he had a heavy line. I was like, why are you using such heavy gear? Because you can bend the hooks out, basically. You can, if you get dead bait snagged, you can bend the hooks out and get your rig back, so you don't leave it out there. And I get that, obviously it makes sense. But as you've seen, I do rarely a little bit of dead baiting. And when I do, I'm only, you know,
fishing tiny waters. I'm not casting in a res, so I don't need a shot cleaner in 150 yards, you know what I'm saying? But you do need 18-pound line, and you do need a good wire trace. And I've been reading about up traces and stuff, if you're using live baits or even dead baits sometimes on a suspended float. So I'm going to get some of that as well. So I've got an extra wire trace basically along the line. And for if I ever get snagged and stuff, I might even start making my own wire traces. I used to. I stopped. Like I said, I've fished these places loads of times. I never looked back my hand. Right, let's get on the tips. The tips for fishing. That's the whole point of the video. But people ask me how I'm fishing and what lures I'm using. I say, honestly, it doesn't matter what lure I'm using. You give me any lure on that one. Oh, it's farted. Oh, it's got bad gas. It stinks. Scraps. Yo, mate. Oh. Sorry, dude. I'm just slapping your head then. Oh, you stink, pooey pants. But yeah, now I'm going to go into tips, and I'll put in the description why I just chat loads of stuff. Basically, one of the guys helped me out a lot, Gavin Boosh, asked me basically about pike fishing, lure fishing, and then, bloody scraps. And I wanted to show him how I lure fish, because he asked me, and to me, obviously, it's just a wire tracing and a lure, it's not rocket science, okay? Different rods, I was about to explain, different rods do different things for when you're lure fishing. I'll go on to that, then I'll go on to the tips, and I'll put it in the description. So if you're looking for the tips, just wait a minute, this is about a little bit about pike fishing, ditch fishing. I've got to stop scratch for a second. Yeah, pleasures of working with dogs and children, isn't it? but yeah, my other rod. Okay, so when I'm using the Savage B lure, okay, I like to use this rod. And if you see my other lure fishing video, because obviously someone would watch that one and they're like, why are you using a float rod? I thought, I don't normally use a float rod. I did for a reason, because if I was going to blank that day, I was going to catch a chub or a roach. I was going to salvage my trip. Relevant of YouTube, that's just what I'm like. I like to be very versatile on my rods. And this rod, I bloody love it, man. Honestly, I'd probably snap it now. It's so old, man. I've had it for about 4.5 years now. I've had an 18-pound pike on this bloody thing. And I'll show you the actual rod, because I've had it for ages. I'm actually might even buy another one. It's that good, man. It's like a... Let's see what it says. Test weight, 20 to 40 grams. I think it is a lure rod. I'm not sure. I thought it was a quiver tip because of the red tip. I don't know. It's stiff, basically. It's stiff little rod. It's only like that big, you see what I mean? So it's not very big. You better get it on it. But you know what I mean. You've seen this video. I've caught pike, a lot of carp on it as well, on the float and stuff. But that's 10-pound line, and that needs respawning. Look at the deepness on it. That needs respawning. It's terrible. That's going to hinder my casting. But yeah, this is the rod that I use for surface lures, because it's heavier. And lures that have got more action, you need a stiffer rod, obviously. And it's going to make it work. With a float rod, you know, I'm only bouncing a little lure. Like I said, the lure could be crap. It's just something red, man. I bet you catch a piece of wood with those little fish. They're nuts, as you've seen it. They didn't even sit, just like, bah! So I'm not really worried, like I said, about the rod. But certain lures, you do need certain rods to play with them, okay? And you can get NFL rods, you know, like fishing, sea fishing rods, you know what I mean, for little bass and stuff like that. Obviously, bass, what are they called? I've done a video on them. Rass. You can get some really cool little rods like that. But one good thing is about having a long rod on a little ditch is that you can get the width all the way along and cast, and you can go along the back bank. Wherever your rod is, a short rod, it's going to go back to where your rod is. So if your rod's any caught way across the water, it's going to go on an angle. That makes sense? The longer your rod is, the further yourself. Why, you know, when I float fishing on a big river and I've got my 14-foot float rod, there's a reason, do you know what I mean? Because you get a much better angle with the line length and stuff like that. Same with lure fishing, I like to get a better angle. So sometimes a bigger rod can actually help you out. Right, so let's get onto the tips. Right, so it comes to tips, yay, tips, and how I choose my venues, why I choose my venues, and why, like, I don't blank much, not in a big-headed way, but like I said, I think the reason why I'm successful normally as an angler is because I choose the right venue, the right time, and I know how it's fishing and stuff like that. So I don't have to, you know, like, people go traveling miles, and it blows my mind. I'm also like, why are you going so far, man? And they're going to catch the same size fish that I'm catching locally. I just think, what are you doing that for? It was always weird to me traveling around. So I like to stick to, you know, local, so I can really get my teeth into stuff. And some of the places that I go, you wouldn't even think I catch fish. It's because I've been there before. I've tried it before. It's not like I'm trying to con you guys. Like, oh, it's just a new adventure. I've done these videos before, that's what I keep saying. But some of it I haven't done before in videos. But I've been there before. I know what it's like at winter. I know what it's like at summer. I know what it's like at spring. So I know when to hit these type of venues and when not to hit these venues. Like, I went to Linney at the beginning of spring last year, the year before. And I should have went on my tench venue, but I went there, no knowledge of the water, just going to go there and catch a 6-pound tench, you know? And I was like, I turned up and I straight away, I was like, oh my God. And I spoke to the bailiff and he's like, mate, there's no tench been come out yet this season. I was like, ah, if I stayed locally, I would have caught at least a 3-pound tench. Do you see what I mean? So sometimes it's better to stay on the venues you know, because you know how they're going to fish. So with this heavy floods, for example, right? I know my little lake that I fish is going to be flooded, but it's cold. So the fish haven't been moving around as much as they were before. So I'm like, oh, where can I go? My major rivers are just chocolate brown. And I thought, the ditch runs through water, a lot of water quick. So it means that it drops quick. It goes high quick, but drops quick. So if we have heavy rain one day, the next day, that river, that the ditch will drop by about a foot. So that's when I hit the ditch. So I know it's gonna fish well. If I were to go there when it's -2, it's gene clear, really cold. I've done it before. And I've caught one pike on that whole stretch because it's just the way it is. So it's getting the conditions and everything right and choosing the venues on the right days. That's why I think I'm successful. And I stay with my roach fishing. You know, every time I've caught a decent roach, I'm not. One guy was like, when I caught that big roach, the roach bream hybrid, whatever. Yeah, the big, huge 3-pound bloody thing. The guy across the river was like, oh, mate, that was a really lucky catch. And I was like, no, this wasn't luck, mate. It's because I went there on low pressure, it's raining, and I knew the river had dropped a little bit, and it was just perfect for roach fishing. Roach fishing, this muddy water, windy, low pressure, perfect. That's how you get good roach fishing. So you need the variables and knowing which venues to fish. There's no point going to fish for the roach on that little river when it's gene clear, been freezing cold for a week, 2 weeks, and no rain. It's going to be gene clear. They're going to be really spooky. As soon as you catch one, they're going to spook out. So it's choosing the right venues. Same when I go carp fishing. When I go carp fishing, I'm sat there in my brain and I'm like, right, where can I go today? What's going to be the best for me and my YouTube channel? And the reason why I do it like my YouTube channel is that it's the same when I normally do. I don't want to blank. I don't want to blank, right? So I have backup plans all the time. So I think of places like, oh, I'll be like, oh, I'm going to go to this place and then go to this place. Example. It's not carp fishing, but pike fishing. I went to my last, you know, the jack fishing video when I fished two different lakes and I was catching those little jacks. I went to the private lake because I'll show you how it's set. So I've got the private lake here. Then I've got the tench lake with the pike in it. And then I've got the pond next to me. The what's it called? Not the council pond. The park lake, right? So there's three ponds, right? So I'm going to start here. Right in the morning with scraps. So we're fitting. This is about 2 miles from my house, 2.5 miles. So I'll start there. So I know if I blank here, I'll go to the tench lake. So then I'm like, I'm going to blank here. I stayed there for 3 hours. I'm not going to sit there on day blank. So I moved, bang, caught some pike. Right. And then I thought on the way home, I could go there. Do you see what I mean? So I can just leapfrog. So I'm always thinking about these type of things, how to go back to where I got like a little chesty cough where I stood out in the rain the other day. But yeah, so I'm always thinking about how to back up my fishing, like how to do this. Like, when I ride to work, I look at the wind direction and I'm like, oh my God, it's northeasterly. There's no point today. And people are like, oh, you're a pussy. It's like, no, I've sat in too many northeasterlies, -7s, northerly winds to know when and not to fish. And that, unless you're going on a river, it's pointless, man. And on rivers at the moment are pointless fishing. They're just muddy puddles, man. Everybody, all online, everyone's saying the same thing. It's just brutal for pike fishing at the moment on rivers. People are still catching on still waters and all that, obviously. And I keep saying, like, slack water. It's like, Jesus Christ, go and see my river. There isn't no slack water. It's just one big chugging muddy puddle at the moment. So yeah, it's choosing the right venues on the right day. Say don't blank. There's no point just going somewhere because you want to go there. Because you will blank, do you know what I mean? It doesn't matter if you want to fish there. So I've always, you know, thinking like that. So when I do a video, first thing I think of is where I'm going to fish. It's 2 seconds. But yeah, it's the venues is so important. Wind direction, low pressure, high pressure, sunny, all these things make a big difference to your catch rate. Trust me. Just because you want to fish somewhere doesn't mean you're going to catch. If you're going to go in 30 degree heat and it's been like that for a week and you're going to go carp fishing and you're going to fish on the bottom, you're already going to catch. Okay, you can, I've done it before, you've caught in 30 degree heat. I did it at the private lake when I went to catch. I caught like 3 fish and it's boiling hot. You get the odd day, but general rules are fun, you know? So low pressure, it's raining, I know it has been for 3 days, so I'm going roach fishing. If it's been gene clear and I'm not sure what's going on at the moment, I'm gonna go pike fishing. So you see what I mean? It's just choosing the right venues at the right times and getting everything right for you. Scrappy, start back in 2 seconds. So there we go. You're going to shout now. Are you going to stop now? Being a menace? Trying to work with dogs and children are a nightmare, aren't they? A nightmare. But yeah, so the venues are so important where you're choosing to fish and how you're going to choose it and where you're going to fish them. People will be like, they always say to me, oh, you can have a really good sessions on your pike and that. It's like, I know I would, not in a big head of way, because I'm choosing the right venues to fish. When I'm fishing these ditches, it's not a coincidence I'm getting 10 takes in a day. You know, like someone was messaging me, like, where's this two? I'm like, I laugh my ass off. I'm like, well, you're going to come all the way down from like Manchester way to try and fish in a ditch for pike. Don't you think all these rivers, like all the way driving down the Merritt, do you know how many ditches you drive over? Do you know how many ditches you must drive over every day? You don't even think to fish it. But the one that I'm fishing is special. It's like, if you think like that, you're nuts, man. These venues that I'm fishing are crap. Most people don't even bother with them. Well, they don't bother with them. That's why there's no fishing line. There's no one bother fishing it. Because you just got to think out of the box. That's what I've always done. And then I get people following me afterwards. Seems to be the weather thing. So, I think it's nuts. I had a guy message me from Scotland. Literally from Scotland, asking me about it. I was like, dude, there's ditches all over everywhere, mate. They'd be full of pike. That isn't a special ditch. It's right next to a road with no fish in it, that first one I did. And I know pike that don't get fished for, I mean, as you can see, these fish don't get fished for. They will try and hit a lure 3 or 4 times, man. As long as they don't fill their hooks, they'll keep coming back because they're not fished for. Pressured pike, just like carp, can be assholes. Like, I went to a cheddar, we went to Cheddar Res, right? It's a massive res, loads of pike in it. 100 anglers. One person caught 15 fish. Nobody else caught anything, right? Then everyone started lure fishing 10 minutes before the end of the competition. Everyone's like, rah, rah, rah. We all start chucking out lures. No one catches on anything. 3 days later, I found out a guy caught like 7 fish on lures down there. There's 100 anglers around casting. No wonder why no pike got caught on lures. Do you see what I mean? It's all about pressure and the way they're caught. On the River Act, on one of the rivers that I go fishing, and he said the venue. One of the rivers that I mainly go and fish, right? I had one of my best days there. I had 7 pike in one day, right? And it's all because I went there on the day the level waters dropped. So I was fishing it a lot. I knew the level was going to drop soon. I went there the day they dropped, right? So the levels dropped by like 5 feet. And all the little fish were caught in the mud and stuff. So I went around catching them, using little lures as well. And I just bagged up on perch, pike, everything. Went back 2 weeks later and I seen a lot of anglers come after me. And I was thinking, oh, I'm so glad I moved to these different spots because I caught a pike like out of every spot. All these anglers are coming behind me. And I was like, yes, I caught you first. And yeah, what a coincidence. I said, you caught anything? Nah, mate. You caught anything? Nah, mate. And they're like, you caught anything? Nah, mate. Yes, I have. And it's because I got there before them. And the more the, obviously, like where I fished, honestly, you get queues of people going past you. It's like last week, the last video I did down there, I said to you, there was like 4 people on the bank. And to me, that's a lot. It's a lot of lures getting chucked around and stuff. So the pike just switch off from the lures, basically, and they follow them and not take them and stuff. So you've got to think outside the box, man. That's why I caught on the harder little dead river, because I used dead baits, because I just thought, oh, the lures are just pointless, and they were. I caught, I had 3 runs, basically, on where I was lure fishing all day, you know? So you've got to think differently, you know? When a fish are pressured, but when they're not pressured, little ditches, little rivers, little ravines, anything that's not pressured, trust me, you'll get hit after hit. And like, I keep getting people, and everything people keep saying, it's like, it's got to be like, you know, a 20-pound, like, fish, and it's like, their back would be out of the water. It wouldn't be able to swim around in there. A cormorant would just eat it. And the other thing is, people keep saying to me as well, it's like, I even thought this loads of times. I just say it because I can't bother arguing. But those fish can't be all jacks. They can't be, can they? There's this one 20-pound female led upriver laying babies and they're swimming all down river and I'm just catching all the babies. It doesn't make sense to me. So what I think is, with the ream ditch pike that I catch, the slightly bigger one must be a female and they just don't grow very big. They get stunted like many fish do in small waters. Because I'm not joking, the water I'm fishing is just this deep, man. So no one's fishing it. Didn't you think if it was like 3 foot deep, people would fish it? It's like that in spots. It's even shallower, man. And when it's weedy, as you see, if you watch the video, there's weed all by my feet because the crane are coming dragged all out. Sometimes it's literally unfishable. So I don't get when everyone keeps, or like even me, I put jacks. And I'm thinking, one of them was a female. They must have been. Because there's no way there's like a 30-pound or 20-pound or even a 15-pound pike in there, man. Its back would be out. There's no food for them. So why they're all small little small little fish. But there's obviously a female there. There's a female breeding. I might not call it. I'm not saying I have. But she ain't going to be 20-pound. I think they're just stunted and they must just be breeding about 4 or 5 pound. Because I found that in all the ditches I've fished. And people always like say to me, oh, there must be a bigger one, like a female somewhere. And I'm thinking, I must have had one. There's no way out of all those fish, not one of them is female, they're all male. Like, what would the rates be? That would make sense. And every fish is a jack, is a male, technically, I think. If I got this wrong, put it in the comments. Where's the females? I think that's what I always get confused with. Every time you catch a small fish, people go, jack. Oi! And you start, nothing, it's a reflection. Oi, Stephen, it's your reflection, you weirdo. So yeah, I always think that's weird when they're like, jack, jack, jack. And you're thinking, well, where's the female then? Like, I've caught 20 jacks. What, the all-male ratio of pike, that 95% are jacks. Like, it don't really make sense. All the big pike are females. I know that. So if you've got a 25-pound pike, generally, it's going to be a female. I think males only go up to, like, single figures, they're near double. Yeah, probably singles, I think, maybe near double. But, yeah, so I must have caught a female. Or if I haven't, there's a female about 6 pounds in there, and that's it. There isn't going to be, you know, some 30-pound peep. Like, how people think, it does make me laugh, because they're like, oh, there's got to be, a female partner. I'm thinking, what do you think there is? Like a 20-pound female living in a ditch, laying babies, and they all seem to go down river, and then I catch them all coming up. Like, you know, it is a bit weird, isn't it? Right, so anyway, it's about my weird, it's not ranting, is it? It's just talking about where I fish, how I fish, why I fish, at different venues. Yeah, it's all to do with weather, first thing, right? Then it's the venue, and then it's the type of fish. So, right, you can mix them around, obviously. You can be like, right, type of fish I want to fish for. Right, I want to fish for roach. Right, where's going to be the best place for fish roach today? If it's been heavy raining for 2 days, the river. If it's been still water. You see what I mean? You just got to get used to what certain water, certain days. Like, I want to go perch fishing. Try to do it 3 times. I can't because the conditions are not right. The water level hadn't dropped and I went down there. They're muddy as anything at the moment and it's chocking through. You can't even hold the bottom properly. So, I can't perch fish. I'm not just going to go there and blank 3 times because I want to perch fish. I've got to wait to the right time so I go down there. And when I do the video, everyone will be like, oh, you got loads of perch. I've done a video where I caught 30 perch, well, over. I caught like 40 perch, man. Maybe more than that. On worms. And that's the right day, right time, right place. It wasn't by accident. That's what I keep saying to people. I don't want to sound big-headed, but when I go to places and I catch, I'm always like, it's not by accident. Because it's not. By accident, it's just going to a venue, hoping hell, casting out of a lure and going, oh, poof, I've got 18-pound pike. That was lucky, wasn't it? Do you see what I mean? So I'm all about, I choose the venue, the right time, blah, blah, blah. And I have been lucky in my angling. I've got, you know, when I caught my first big pike, it was 18-pound pike, caught on a dead bait, 17-pound pike, on a dead bait, big reds. I just cast it out. That was just pure fluke. I didn't go there because of the conditions. I didn't go for any other reason, but I got invited. So it does happen like that. But what I'm saying is, to up your catch rate, you have to put all the variables into a sort of slot. Then go, right, that is going to be the best. It's whatever, I don't care what I want to do. It depends on what the weather dictates and what venue, then what fish, you know? So anyway, I hope this helps you guys. Like and subscribe. I've got a Patreon channel and we're doing only videos for patrons. Don't worry, you'll still be getting stuff on YouTube. It'll just be different stuff, rig making and just random stuff to help me along. And I've got a new adventure. I'm opening up a gym. Boom! You'd be like, you got a gym? It's like, no, I rent a space, basically. And I run my own, you know, side of the gym. But now I want to go off on my own and create my own gym. So I'm going to be even more busy. But, you know, when people say to me, oh, I ain't got time to fish like you on YouTube. I fish once a week at the moment. When I first started YouTube, I was smashing it. I was doing like 3 videos a week sometimes. At the moment, obviously, I've got so much going on. I can do 1 video a week. That's all I can sort of promise. And sometimes I can't even promise that. The weather doesn't dictate it. But that's going to be my aim at the moment. So obviously, I've got to get my gym sorted. I've got a job as well, cleaning lorries in my spare time, as well as being a PT and teaching every night. I'm teaching boxing. So 6 days a week at the moment, I teach Muay Thai and boxing. And then I clean lorries in the day, 1 day a week, just for extra cash. I did doing that today. That's why I'm just a finesse, you know. It's freezing cold. So yeah, I'm going to be opening up my own gym and make some money. And then I'm going to come out with some gold bling on. And I'm going to have like the best rods, the best nets. And I'm going to have Delcams. And I'm just going to turn into a turd. No. Yeah, I won't even buy any new gear. You know, I'm like, some guy was like, oh, you need a lure rod. Like, nah, don't, mate. Make do, you know, hand-me-downs, innit, you know? I don't get into all that kind of stuff, as you know. Even if I made money, you're not going to see me wearing gold rings. You're not going to see me wearing nice stuff. I don't care, man. Same with my fishing gear, and it's not going to change. I'm not going to go out and spend £300 on a rod or whatever, just because, you know, the only time I ever spend is a flat, so if I really need it, right? I don't need a lure rod. I really don't. I say that in 6 months, you can see me with a brand new lure rod. I'm like, you know, the gym's doing well. But you see what I mean? Like, there's a couple of things I need, but I can make do for the minute. It's like this reel. It's a really good little reel. I love it because it's really small. I bought it cheap ages ago. But where is it? I can't take this off. This is fused on. So I can't flick the handle down. You know, just little things, but you just get around it, don't you? And same with my float rod. Bought this for a tenner, like I said. Where is it? Yeah, this eye's broken. See, so I have to fix that. I'd probably take it out of the shop and get it fixed. Went to the local tackle shop, actually fixed this and stuff like that. About a tenner, I think. So, yeah, you know, simple things. Oh, yeah, there we go. 2 seconds before I lose my plot. You know what I'm like, rabbiting on. But basically, venues. So basically, all you've got to do, it's very simple, guys. Wire trace, okay. My little clip. I know some, oh, hey, Scrappy. I know some of you will know this, it all seems stupid to you, but people don't know. You don't know, do you? Knowledge is power, peeps. Knowledge is power. Okay, and then I put the clip back down to lock it on. So she's locked on. That would help, wouldn't it? You think, the amount of time I've been on YouTube, you think I would know this stuff now, wouldn't you? Yeah. Right, let me. It's not going to do it, is it? Come on, Huawei. But yeah, so you just lock it on. It's not rocket science, trust me. You could even get him in a tackle shop to show you how to do it. It's very quick. It's easier. It's the easiest fishing I know. And the last bit. And I shut me cake hole. One of the biggest pike I caught out of a small river. I've got it on YouTube. I've got two pike in the same spot with this bad boy. And what I did is just stuck worms on it. I just stuck loads of worms on it. Cast it down there. Bounce, bounce. Boom. Mofo, we're into a pike. So worms, trust me, Jack Pike love worms. Same thing that video I did. I bet you I could have done that on worms. Jacks love worms. And I could probably have done that with a dead fish, just cast and draw it. So I say, when the pike don't, you know, are not fished for, they will hit anything, man. You look at some of the old school lures, they're just pieces of wood, wouldn't they, you know? And a little spinner on it. They hit anything. I've had, for example, where I go ditch fishing, this is why I started doing it. I was there with a float. Every time I pulled back the float, a little jack hit the float. I was like, what the hell was that? It's like a little snake. So then I did a video of me actually lure fishing down there. The first one, it's a while back now. So yeah, it just shows, do you know what I mean? This type of fishing. Just think about what you're doing, where you're going, different venue, how to catch more fish. It's the only way, guys, to go. Right, anyway, I'm going to start wrapping it in. I'm losing myself now. But right, like and subscribe to my channel. I know it's just a random one. It's just tips for fishing, how I'm fishing, and why I fish certain venues. I won't just go fish somewhere for the sake of it. Right, so like and subscribe. Fighting Fisherman number 9 on Instagram. Fighting Fisherman on Facebook. Got me clothing. Got a bobble hat getting sent out. I haven't even got one myself. Getting sent out. I will be having one as well. So if you want any of my clothing, the merch, and if you want to help me out on Patreon, you know, I'm going to be doing probably a whole video log about my gym and how I created it and stuff like that. Just something a little bit different. You know what I mean? I'm going to put that on Patreon, just show you into my little world of madness. Right then, guys. Ciao for now. Be back, Bosh.